are welcome to living food. We praise the Lord for his abiding love, and his readiness to instruct us in his word. Even today, he is here to speak to us and equip us for victorious Christian living. This program continues the messages on the Christian home, which have been on living food. Your home can achieve the purpose for which God set it up. Only be diligent to stick to his instructions, even as they come your way today. Do feel free to initiate personal discussions with us, even on this matter, as you write us. Request your enrollment form for the discipleship by corresponding program, if that be your desire. Our address is Living Seed, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Living Seed, P.O. Box 971, Boko, Benue State, Nigeria. Let me request you to bring your Bibles, to invite your friends, and to take notes as we go along this very important program today. I invite our Bible teacher to lead us from here, even as we bow down to pray. Shall
we pray? Our Father and our God, we give you praise. We bless you because of your very presence with us. We also thank you for another opportunity you are granting to us to look into your word, even the perfect law of liberty. We pray for those that are listening to us, that your word will make you fresh within them, and will bring about a definite intervention into the various homes and families in the name of Jesus Christ. Grant definite understanding unto your word with us today. Thank you for hearing us, for we prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank God for bringing us your way again today, especially to continue the series we began last week on the Christian home. And I started by dealing with the fact of why must we pay close attention to this important aspect. What is the need to take a study, especially a series on the Christian home? And we read a scripture from the book of Proverbs, chapter 30, verse 21 to 23. We saw that there are four things that causes the earth to tremble, that causes confusion in the whole earth, and the earth cannot actually tolerate it, can't bear it. And out of these four things, which we read and studied last week, we found that out of these four, two of these four are having something to do with the family. So we concluded that in almost every case, 50% of the troubles in this world, they are problems from the family. 50% of all the wrong influences that you see in the life of children, they come from their home. 50% of all the confusion you are seeing, whether in politics, whether in the educational system, or in our social life, they all emanate from the troubles in the family. I believe that if God will touch our homes, if God will touch our families, he has touched 50% of our troubles. And today again, I again want to impress upon you, why must you bring in Jesus onto your marriage? Why must you bring in Jesus onto your relationship? Why must you please sit down and invest some quality time as we look into the Word of God to see what is his wisdom for our families? May God grant you understanding as we go on in the name of Jesus Christ. I want us to turn our Bibles together back to the book of John chapter 2. I began to introduce that scripture last week, but today, by the grace of God, we would like to pay more attention, close attention, onto issues that the Holy Spirit is raising in this particular story. John chapter 2, I'd like to read it from verse 1 to 10. I'm reading from the King James Version. And the third day, there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee, and the mother of Jesus was there. And both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. And when they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said to him, "They have no wine." Jesus said to her, "Woman, what have I to do with thee? My hour is not yet come." His mother said unto the servant, whatsoever he says to you, do it. And there was set there 6 water pots of stone, after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, containing 2 or 3 fackings apiece. Jesus said to them, fill the water pots with water. And they filled them up to the brim. And he said unto them, draw out now, and bear unto the governor of the feast, and they bear it. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servant who drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and said unto him, every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men are well drunk, then that which is worse, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. May God bless his word to our hearts in Jesus' name. Now, the question I'm raising before you is, why must we sit down to study and to pray and to bring Jesus into your marriage? Young lady, I know you are very beautiful. I know you are very, very enterprising. I believe that maybe you have learned some psychological techniques of wooing and winning the heart of your husband. I don't doubt, young man, that you are really, really enjoying your relationship with your wife, I suppose. But I want to draw your attention to a need why you must bring Jesus onto that marriage. And that's what I want to deal with. Why must I bring Jesus onto my family? Why must I bring Jesus onto my relationship? Why must I bring Jesus onto our home? Why must I bring in Jesus? That's our focus of study right now. And from the story that we have read, the Bible said there was a marriage in Cana of Galilee. And the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. When they wanted wine. Now, when you read it from King James, and the way he put it, when they wanted wine, it will look as if it was just an ordinary want. But if you read it from other versions of scriptures, it might be clear to you, and I want us to note it. I read from Good News. Good News says, when all the wine had been drunk, Jesus said to him, they are out of wine. Philip's Modern English put it like this. It says, the supply of wine gave out, and Jesus' mother told him, they have no more wine. New English Bible says, they have no wine left. They have no wine left. That's what the mother of Jesus came to say. The wine gave out. So Jesus' mother said to him, they have no wine left. Now, so the word we note in verse 3, that say when they wanted wine, I want to say that when their wine finished, when the wine gave out, when all the wine that started that marriage was finished. Now, I want to wait before I come back on this scripture to make some certain comments. I'm trusting that God will help you. Now, but I want you to jump from that verse 3 very quickly, and I want you to move down to verse 9. And that's where we are going to really begin our study. When the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, and knew not whence it was, but the servant who drew the water knew, the governor of the feast called the bridegroom, and he said to him, every man at the beginning does set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, then that which is worse, but thou hast kept the good wine until now. Now, let's look at what the word of God actually is beginning to say. And I want you to listen and ask God to open your eyes of understanding. Now, the Bible said something that looks normal. But as I look at the word of God, I see the Holy Spirit saying something very critical and very crucial that I want you to listen to. Now, when the wine finished in that marriage, everybody was running helter-skelter. It looks as if the joy of that marriage was going to collapse. It seems as if the excitement was going to finish. And all of this was taking place. The chief governor of the feast, somebody like the MC,
or the chief host was beginning to cry and say, oh, one has finished. What are we going to do right now? What are we going to do right now? And the mother of Jesus brought Jesus into that matter, and a miracle took place. But that is not what I'm talking about as yet. I want you to follow me. Now, when the ruler of the feast had tasted the water that was made wine, he did not know where it came from, except the servants that drew the water that knew that Jesus performed a miracle. It was then the governor of the feast called the bridegroom. And look at what the man said. That was the beginning of our understanding. And he said to him in verse 10, every man. And I want you to please mark that. Every man. What's the meaning of every man? Every man. Every man. Regardless of their education, whether they are educated or they are not educated, this matter I want to talk about is common to every man. In every culture, in every place, in every nation, every man at the beginning does set forth good wine. Listen carefully to me, madam. Listen carefully to me, oh young man. The Bible says, every man at the beginning, at the beginning of marriage, whenever any man is looking for a woman to marry, what does the Bible say he does? He sets forth the good wine. Every man, when they are looking for someone to relate with, they don't bring out the bad wine. They don't bring out the bad aspect of their life. Every man at the beginning does sell for good wine. That is what every man does. And I want you to listen carefully. I've never yet met a couple that started their relationship when they were talking, that started with fighting. I've not yet met any like that. I've never met a man wanting to go and woo a girl or propose to a girl, and the first thing he went to do was to slap the girl and give her a dirty slap, blah, and say, yes, I really, really want to show you that I love you. That's why I came to slap you. If anybody should do that to you while you are still contemplating whether to agree with that man or not, what will you do, my dear sister? I know that you will stop it. You say, a man that is beating me before we get married. No, I can't stay with a monster like that. I know that relationship will stop. Listen, but all of you listening to me today, those of you that your husband started beating you, did he start beating you when he started proposing to you? When he started coming to your house? When he started writing the letter? Now, if I may ask you to do something, those of you that are very meticulous, can you go into your archives? And I know so many women, they keep letters, especially the letters of their lovers. The letters that your lover wrote to you when you were beginning. I remember that you were just finishing your secondary school that time. Bring out those letters. What were the content that your husband was writing to you then? Was he not saying, yes, my dear Debbie, your name was Deborah. He said, my dear Debbie, I look all over the world. There is nobody like you. You are the only one that fits into my life. Out of all the flowers in the garden, none smell like you. You are the rose of my life. And I remember how many times you read that letter. Could you sleep? No. Anytime that man wrote you that letter, you were always intoxicated. You can't sleep. You even carry it in your handbag. In the taxi, you will just take it and smile to yourself and look at it and shake your neck. Whenever he's visiting you, you see all the kind of things he will bring. He said, I just think you will like this. He will bring you beverages. He will bring you different things. The handkerchief that he will continue to buy for you, the pomade and the perfume. Every man at the beginning, they do set forth good wine. Are you understanding what I'm saying? Now, look at the same husband that started like that with you today. What is he doing? What is his activity to you right now? What do you think has happened? Something must happen.
Now the Bible said every man, and you see all the women that got into trouble now, that keep shouting on their husband, that keep locking up their husband and say, I will show you my true color right now. If they actually brought out their true color when you are starting, when you are going into that relationship, you will never have gone there. But what am I saying today? Why must you bring Jesus into this marriage? It is because the attitude, the manifestation of a man at the beginning of every marriage does not conclusively tell us how he will behave in 5 years' time. A man that you think is so gentle, is so very, very loving, is so very, very caring, and that before you cough, he's already there with support. Even when you just knock your feet on the ground carelessly, he's there to say sorry to you. We cannot use that one to tell what he will behave, what he will do in 2 years to come. I see some of you young girls, you are listening to me today, and you are saying, no, don't tell me. That boy is the best thing that has ever happened in my life. I don't doubt it. I am not arguing with you. But I'm telling you that at the beginning, every man does search for good wine. All those people that are now divorced, go and ask them, how did they start their marriage? How did they start their relationship? It was probably better than what you are going through now. Those men had better language. They had better time. They brought money. They brought resources. They bought different kind of attires for their wives, for their intended wives. Every man at the beginning, are you listening to me? They set forth good wine. Why did they do that? And when men have were drunk, when men have become intoxicated, you see, that's what I'm trying to say to you today. That in every home, in every relationship, God said this is what every man does. When you want to woo a girl, you do the best. When you want to win the heart of a man, you give him the best. Remember the last time your fiancé was trying to visit you, what did you do? You claimed to go house. You arranged some flowers on the table. Will you always do that? No. That is only meant for the beginning. So that when the person is well drunk with love, well drunk with intoxication, well drunk with excitement, well drunk with all your care, well drunk with all this superficiality, then that which is worse. My friend, I want you to sit down and think very quickly now. The behavior that your husband is bringing forth now, could you reconcile with what he started with? Remember how your husband promised you heaven and earth. How he told you that, look, who are those girls in the world that he will think about? You are the best, and that you are the only one he loves. He doesn't have time to look for anyone. He has taken time to check all women before he came and made this the proposal to you, and that you are the one that suits him so well. What has happened right now? Is he not the same husband that the last time he was leaving house, he banged the door on your face? Was he not the same husband that started shouting on you in the presence of your children? Was he not the same man that decided to show you money, saying, this is money, but I'm not going to give you, you're not going to smell it? Was he not the same man that is now maltreating you, and he doesn't have time for you again? He goes out very early in the morning, and he doesn't come back until very late. And when he comes back late, you will see him sitting before the television, gluing his eyes there, just to avoid you. The same man that said he couldn't sleep without you for 2 days, is he not living in a different room right now? And the last time you wanted to see him, what did he say? Say, look, I don't want disturbance. But, professor, are you hearing me? You are hiding the fact that the wine that started your marriage has ended. You are hiding it under your research. He said, you see, I have to write this my paper. That's why I have to be in the laboratory. Sorry for you. Were you not a researcher when you started this marriage? As soon as it was 7 p.m., what did you do? You finished everything. all the chemicals that you are going through, you say, look, let it wait, I'll come back tomorrow. But what is happening now? You are, I see you in your laboratory up to 1 a.m. in the middle of the night. Why? The wine has finished. Brother, sister, I want to ask you a very pertinent question. There are three questions. Number one, if you are not yet married, if you are just courting somebody, if you are just on the level of proposal, don't you think you need to bring Jesus onto this relationship? Because whereas every man started with good wine, you cannot predict what this man that you are running after will do to you tomorrow. Even when you go and ask him and say, will you deny me? Will you disappoint me? That does not answer the question I'm raising with you. I remember some of you, you have even sucked your blood. When that man was trying to get you committed, he caught you and said, let me suck your blood. And you suck mine. So that we enter into a blood covenant. What has he done with all of that right now? What has he done with all of that now? Another girl is in his life. And you have been put aside. Oh my God, it's so painful. They are put away on your own life. You are just like a gadget right now in the house. Now, that's the situation that is going on with you today. The fact that the man is very promising does not answer the fact that tomorrow he can change. Don't you see why you need to bring Jesus onto this relationship? Because the good one you are enjoying today, the good one that is making you not to have time for the word of God today, it will soon finish. It will normally finish. Are you hearing me? There are some of you listening to me now. The reason why you don't want to hear the gospel, the reason why you don't want to give your life to Jesus, the reason why you don't want to surrender your heart to Jesus, is the fact of that boy in your life. You feel that if I should repent now, I will lose the boy. I am sorry that you don't understand that boy you are running after now, for which you are losing eternity, for which you are losing your relationship with Jesus Christ, tomorrow he may change. The good one is setting forth may finish. And what may remain may just be ordinary dregs. And you will have missed the reality. Why must he bring in Jesus? Because no man is predictable. Man can change, but Jesus remains the same. Hallelujah. Madam, maybe you are married. And your marriage is moving fine. And so as we are preaching, you say, no, don't talk to me. He's talking to those that have problems in marriage. Seriously, let me tell you. That man you see today, that woman you see today, I have met people that for the first 20 years of their marriage, it looked as if there was not going to be a problem. But after 20 years, they went and brought in another woman. It's so painful that your firstborn, Oga, your firstborn has finished university. Your firstborn is an architect. And at the age of 23, after many years of marriage, 25 years of your marriage, what are you doing with another girl? What are you doing with that other same woman? I know what has happened. The wine of your life has finished. The wine of your marriage has ended. This is why you are not finding fault with your wife. This is why you are finding fault with your husband. The wine has finished. The wine has finished. But let's see, what am I saying? Because the wine in men's life will normally finish. Except Jesus will come and turn it around. It will normally become water. The wine will become water. The love will become watered love. The soup will become watery. The joy will become watery. The romance will become watery. Everything will finish if you don't bring in Jesus. But let's see what the word of God did. The Bible said, and both Jesus was called and his disciples. My friend, if you will not lack wine, you must bring in Jesus. The only thing that can sustain you and your husband is to bring in Jesus. Don't depend on what he's doing right now. Don't depend on his ability. Don't depend on the words of his promises. It is not enough to sustain your marriage. The wine normally will finish. But what was the wise thing to do? Both Jesus was called and his disciples. Why must you cause your marriage to be in the presence of Jesus? He's the only one that can sustain it. He's the only one that can sustain it. And look at the Bible. Just before I end, in case you are already in a situation where the wine has finished, you just realize that your husband doesn't love you again. You just realize that those romance have become watery. Your relationship has become watery. What must you do? Do what the mother of Jesus did. She came and told Jesus. She came and told Jesus. He said, Master, the wine has finished. The wine of my marriage has finished. The wine of my relationship has finished. The wine of my love has finished. And let Jesus do something about it. The woman was not hiding it. As I see some of you, you are camouflaging. You beat yourself in the bedroom. Then you come out with a uniform. That is camouflage. Come and repent. Come and tell Jesus. Come and humble your heart before the Lord. And say, the wine has finished. And look at what Jesus did. The mother of Jesus understood. Said, whatsoever is said to you, do it. And I want to end at that point. When you bring Jesus into your marriage, be ready to obey him. Whatever he says to you today, do it. As Jesus steps into your marriage, he will turn that watery love, that watery relationship, that watery romance, he will turn it back to wine. The wine that will keep your life going. The wine that will sustain your relationship. But you must come to Jesus. You must do whatever he tells you to do today. As we stop here, what is your confidence? Is your confidence because your husband has money today, money will finish? Is your confidence because the man is always showing you that everything is alright, it will soon finish? Bow your head right now. Bring in Jesus. Whatsoever I tell you to do, do it. Repent and release unto the hand of God. That marriage will be delivered from collapse. God bless you. Our Father, we thank you. Thank you for bringing us to this point when you are putting firmly your finger, O God, on the source of our problems in our families. Lord, there are several men now that are bowed, inviting the Lord Jesus. We want to ask that you will help them henceforth to obey very strictly the word of the Lord in their lives. Give them instructions henceforth and help their situations. Thank you that you will do it, O Lord, for we are prayed in Jesus' name. Amen. Don't be mistaken. The source of the problem in your family is simply this. The